During the last 2 days, what I just saw, the routine or the schedule of your workshop or the school program, which is having the which must have covered the your basics of the blockchain. So today what I will do is that I will just wrap up the blockchain in one or two slides. What does it show? And then I will discuss about the important issue, or you can say the crucial issue there in the permissionless blockchain. What is the scalability is a crucial issue, and we'll discuss that how the both the scalable, and when you design the solution for the scalability, particularly the off-chain mechanisms for the blockchain, then how the security can be preserved or security can be intact. That we will discuss, and we will discuss few mechanisms, few recent mechanisms, how they handle the security while developing the scalable solution for the permissionless blockchain. Well, to start with, let me again wrap up. Yesterday you must have discussed what a blockchain is. So I would say that in a one way that the blockchain is an indispensable technique or indispensable tool to facilitate trust among the participant when the participants are not having trust. So I would say that the participants are trustless, they are not trusting each other. Now you want to establish a trusted environment among the participants without a centralized authority. Of course, it is quite convenient if I say that there are few participants are there and there is something central server, then what happens is establishing trust is not be an issue, because this participant A is trusting the central and the participant B is also trusting the central, and through this they can establish a trust. That's quite convenient. But the question comes that when the participants are not trusting each other, and even there is no centralized authority. So in such an environment, the blockchain could be an indispensable tool. So what a blockchain is, in one sentence I could say that it is a chain of blocks, as the name indicates, the block and the chain. So I would say that the chain of blocks that contains information. What information we'll discuss in the next few slides, of course. Remember that it is not a new concept. The concept, if you look at back around 1991, there are some papers by Haver and Sonata. They said they developed a technique to call that to timestamp digital documents so that it cannot be tampered. Let me tell you an example. I have written a document and I gave it to Professor Ramakrishna, and Professor Ramakrishna will say change it certain times, certain in the document. And tomorrow onwards, or after certain times, if I want to see that who has originated this document, who has modified this document, then there must be certain evidence. So again, this particular problem can be solved if say that there are two participants, A has initiated the document given to a central party. Central party will keep a timestamp. And he wrote that, okay, this is shown and the timestamp. So, and send these things to him. And the latter end, when say Ramakrishna has asked that, okay, I need to modify, see, he modified it. Then what happens? This again, he will send it to this server. Server will write this, yes, Ramakrishna. And then he signed it, put a digital sign, including timestamp. Then what happens later on, if I see, then Ramakrishna said, I modify this document because this is with me, that it is with the central server, and I trust the central servers. So both Soma and Ramakrishna are trusting the central server. So therefore this problem is very trivial. All right. Now, what happened that Haver and Stoneta put a coin into this, that when there is no centralized authority, how will you solve this problem? So they, what they did is that they established the hash chain mechanisms, though they did not call it the name as the blockchain we call, but they have like this way, okay, the hash of this document and the client number and this timestamp, and then they will sign it out. So then this is contained in the previous HAAS. So what happens? Then this is and so on and so on. So what will happen? Now if I wish to change something here, then what happens? This needs to be changed because this contains the previous HAAS and so on. Right, then if so and so, then it is really the difficulty or the infeasibility is going on increasing, right? So in this way they solve this problem, and this particularly given insight, and now this blockchain is a buzzer with this concept. Okay, we'll discuss again how, what extra more things are there, right? Hope everybody could understand. So the Hauer and Stoner in 1991, they produced this particularly paper name is How to Timestamp a Digital Document. In 1992, they introduced the concept of Merkle tree, which is also this concept you can find it in the blockchain. Okay, and after that, in 2008, Satoshi Nakamoto, the first application of this blockchain technology, they introduced which in 2008. Okay, and later on, of course, it is growing. Now it become a buzzer in every applications we are about to use the blockchain. Still, we do not understand where we should use blockchain and where the blockchain is not a better solution to. If somebody asks that, okay, whether the blockchain is suitable for my solution, you need to identify that whether you have a centralized server with you, and you have a centralized trust server with you, and then no, nothing required for this like environment, this blockchain. Okay, because I have a trusted server. Well, now it can be used for secure transfer of money, property, contracts without involving a trusted third party like bank or government. A huge number of applications. Now, so what you understand is that blockchain is a chain of blocks that contain information. And where this information is now, I would say that, you see that this is a distributed environment. The information is stored, you can say that redundantly, right? In duplicate way. So you can see that, okay, the, this is say on node A, B, C, D, E, and F, all have this same information, right? Okay, so my mechanism would be like this way. So they are cryptographically linked list of blocks. These are the cryptographically linked list of blocks. If you look at this simple linked list, right? What you have is that you have a something on this and the previous node. So this node address is stored here, right? So this is called the previous node and so on, so on. This is your normal linked list. Here, of course, what you're doing previous node in the sense, address of the previous node you are storing here, right? Rather than that, what I stored here, the previous node's HAAS. So what the HAAS of this previous node's HAAS is stored here, clearly? So therefore we call it a cryptographically linked list of blocks. And it is with some constraints. If I would say that, okay, it is a linked list, then I can insert in this middle also, right? You have designed your programs, okay? Now, here, of course, it is not possible. We are not giving that, what you consider that facility. So you can append only at the end, this block. Next is that it is replicated. Because see, I can see that in the A is having this blockchain, B is having, and so on. All the nodes are having replicated and distributed. So because, as I told you that the blockchain, the same information is lying at all the different nodes, then there is a requirement of the consistency. So how the consistency will maintain? Consistency will be maintained by certain algorithms, which is called the consensus algorithms. So if you look at the blockchain, there the consensus algorithms were using the proof of work. Okay, similarly, certain proof of stack, okay? And proof of time and many things, many different consensus algorithms are existing, okay? And you have the proof of authority and so on. The cryptographically assured, the integrity of data is ensured or assured by cryptographic mechanisms, right? As I told you that, the huge applications of blockchain, starting from the digital ID, Bitcoin, real estate, payments and transfers, law enforcement, healthcare, online music, banking, IoT, and so on. So in most of the areas, the blockchain has touched upon, and you can find the application of your blockchain. Therefore, I would say that this is a buzzer nowadays, right? Now, look at the major functionalities of the blockchain applications. So users, what the user does is that it initiates a transaction using their digital signatures. So it is a single transaction, right? Then what the user does is that it broadcasts the transaction to nodes. So here I call the nodes, means in the sense, I call the name as the miners, right? So user broadcast the transaction to nodes. One or more nodes begin validating each transaction to maintain a transaction pool, validate the transactions, keep in the transaction pool. Then nodes aggregate these valid transactions, aggregated because within the pool, then after some time they aggregate all the things, then create a block. Then nodes broadcast the blocks to each other. You know,
sorry to interrupt, sir. Sir, you are moving your slides or just you are talking? I'm like,
no, I'm moving my slides now.
But it is not moving slides, sir. You please verify it, sir. Here only first slide is only visible. No other slides, sir.
Oh, is it so? Just let me check it out.
Yeah, now it is moving. It is moving, sir. That earlier only for that slide is only.
Just let me check it out. Now, could you see?
Now it is okay, sir. Now it is moving.
Now, could you see the NSF? What is written in that slide?
Major functionalities of BC application.
No. You are in that previous slides. It is okay. With me, it is Bitcoin. So some problem is there. Just let me go here.
Now Bitcoin is being displayed, sir.
No, because it is my, I'm not in this mode. Okay. Just please give me a minute. Could you see my slides now?
Yes, sir.
The blockchain slide is being visible.
Yeah.
Now?
Yeah, moving, sir. Now.
Now moving.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So,
sir, you please write something, then let us know that.
No, I'm in the application of blockchain. Could you see the slide?
Sir. Yeah, okay. Yes, sir.
Right. Yes. So, right. This already discussed it out. So the major functionality of a blockchain application is that user initiates the transaction, then broadcast the transaction to the nodes. One or more nodes validate the transactions, then they aggregate it. After aggregating the form, or they create a block, right? Then they broadcast that block. Then it comes to the consensus protocol. Let us imagine that there are different nodes, as we have discussed now. There is a node, say, I call it the A, B, C, and D, and A is having its own transaction pool and created a block. Similarly, each node created blocks. They are connected with certain users. Remember that they have the transactions, and one transaction pool of B may or may not have all the transactions in his transaction pool of C. Then the block formed by B would be different from that of the C. But as I told in the beginning, all the nodes at the end, they should have a certain state. They should preserve the same state. That means they have to have the same blockchain. How to solve this problem? So this comes into the picture of the consensus protocol. So as I told you, that is proof of work. Now there will be a racing between these all the nodes when they form a block. So there is something in the Bitcoin I will show in the next slide, of course. This is called at the previous time bits nodes. Oh, here not written. Okay, there is something that called the I will have a particular. Yes, this is the nodes. Yes. The nodes value. This nodes will be such that to have the all the information will be there. Then they will create a hash of this. Okay, and this hash value is supposed to have certain number of zeros at the beginning. That is challenge, right? So accordingly that the nonce is to be changed. The nonce is to be formed in such a way that the total house will have certain number of zeros. Hope you could follow me out. So you see that how difficult is it. Now let us say it is 120 I bit. Of course, here we are using the 256 bit hash digest. If 256 bit hash digest, when I take the all the information and hash it, I will get a number, right? But my requirement is if I say that at least one should be zero, then what will be happening? Then I need to get 1/2 space I'm using. Okay, this space rather than 0 and 1. So I'm not using this one, if it is invalid, and 0, that is 1/2. So if I'm having the 20 bit, or I would say that 50 bits of this, then 1/2 to the power 50 and so on. This many calculations, therefore it becomes with hardened jobs, right? Okay. So then in this challenge, who will win? Who will win in this challenge? That will be winner, or that miner, I will say the winner, and he will get some award. And this is this coins he will get it. That is called the coin based transaction. Okay, I hope I'm clear now. So then the blocks reflecting the true state. Once it is done, then I call this state is a true state. Hope I'm clear. If any questions until this? No questions. Great. So now you can see that the version of the blockchain version, that is 4 bytes. Previous hash, just as I told you, this is the 32 bytes. Just what I told you, 256 bits. So the time, what time the block is created, and the bits. And the bits is the challenge that in the overall you can see that the number of bits to be zeros, or I would say that the hash digest must be less than such and such numbers. I will calculate from this. And this is the nonce and the transaction root. What the transaction root? It is the Merkle tree, and this root is this. Okay, and the similar things will happen with all the blocks. The block header, what I just told you, this block header is of 80 bytes, followed by all the transactions. I believe that you must have discussed yesterday in the blockchain fundamentals. Well, so with this, what advantage I get it that no single point of failure, because it is a distributed system. Even if one node fails, it does not harm the system, other nodes will take care of. Verifiable audit trail of changes, just as I told you that all the nodes are very fine. And immutability of data, just as I told you that if the data of this node changes, then I need, because the hash will be changed, and once this hash will be changed, this need to be changed, and if this need to be changed, this need to be changed, and so on and so on. Okay, so immutability of data, suitable for many applications where parties have no trust, they can exchange value digitally by creating a trust or by establishing trust. However, the system is having certain limitations. What limitations? They are slow and expensive to maintain and hard to scale. Okay. Hope these two limitations are clear. Again, I will make it clear in the next slides how it is coming. Now I'm taking an example. Yesterday, just I took this example, yesterday means 2 days back, that what is the Bitcoin throughput? It is from this idea, this site. Okay. I'm in a talk now. Please call me up. Okay. All right. So you can see that the average number of transactions per block is coming to this 1835. Okay. So with this, if I would calculate, then the average block size, which is coming to be 1.11 MB. So the block size is 1.11 MB and the number of transactions is 1835. Averagely calculated. So I took it from the 1 year data, 19th, 12 December 2020 to 17th, 12, 2021. Okay. So average, just I took it of approximately 1 MB per block. And each transaction, if I consider that a 250 byte, on average, some transactions will be more and some transactions will be less in size. Then around 4,000 transactions per block is coming. You know, from the yesterday class must be that the Bitcoin one block takes around 10 minutes. So hardly we can get that a 6.7 transactions per second. Hope it is clear now. So if you look at the scalability, or look at the number of transactions per second, the throughput, right? The throughput is about 6.7 transactions per second. Similarly, I download from the Bitcoin, Ethereum. The similar things that is coming, it is coming around, there are 21 K gas, 12.5 M gas per block, and 600 transaction per block. So there are one block is 15 seconds. In 15 seconds, one block in the Ethereum. So there are around 40 transactions per second, or you would say that the throughput of Ethereum is 40 transactions per second. Okay. Now, let me look at a little bit aside what exactly the traditional system have. If you look at the Visa, which is having around 24,000 transactions per second. Ripple is having 1,500. PayPal 193. And if you look at this Ethereum 20 and Bitcoin, and the upper side, I took it at 7 transactions per second. So you compare this. So how the throughput is much lesser than the requirement of us. Okay. So this, I just put the note to emphasize that why scaling is important. You can see from this slide that the number of daily transactions grows. So once the transaction grows, it increases the average confirmation time for a transaction. Because many transactions I will have in my pool, it requires to convert confirmations and so on. So sometimes there were around 2 lakh unconfirmed transactions and confirmation time took to more than a day. All right, it happens in 2017 or 18. Nobody will wait for a day. You paid the amount and you say that you are purchasing some things. And I went and created the things and the confirmation time is one day, so that he will not give you that and that things. Okay, so increases the network transaction fees. So what happens if I have more number of transactions with me? So I need to see that, okay, which transaction is giving more fees, I will keep in the block, and as a priority other transactions, I will keep it aside. So then, because it's my profit, right? When you use the block with using a more power, consuming more power, then I will certainly see that how I will be more benefited. Okay, so increases the network transaction fees. It went up to, you know, $60 per transaction in January 2018. Increases the block difficulty, because this, just I told you that bit is a dynamic value, and looking at the number of transactions, the transaction time, etc., the block difficulty, the number of transactions, the block difficulty increases. So the once the block difficulty increases, what happens? The average computation power will increase. Okay, so more electricity is required. So increase the blockchain size massively. So difficult to set up a full nodes to maintain the complete blockchain state for transaction processing and verification. So in nutshell, I want to say that as the number of transactions grows, the system tend to become slower, expensive, and unsustainable for a use case like payment system. So therefore, the scaling has become an inherent factor in a wider acceptance of blockchain system. So this is the importance of to design a scalable solution. So in summarizingly, I would say that if you compare the throughput, which is around 2400 transactions per second for Visa, while 7 transactions per second in Bitcoin. Latency is the 10 minutes on one transaction confirmation, but it took around 1 hour for one block confirmation time because of the number of transactions grows. Again, if you compare the fees, 1.601 in July 2020, but it reached $50 in December 2017. So this is the impact of increasing of the number of transactions. Okay. And therefore, the system is not scalable. Let us find the reason why it could be. In all blockchain protocols, each node stores all states with account balance, contract code, and entire transaction history, just as I told you. Okay. Each node keep the same things. So this is to verify the validity of each transaction in the network without a trusted party. Because there is no trusted party, each node to maintain and validate. So what we gained is that this provides better security. This is what we gain, high robustness. However, it limits scalability to not being able to process more transactions than a single node. What is the capability of a single node that all the nodes are doing the same job? Therefore, there is no scalability. Okay. So I would say this challenge as a, I can say the trilemma, using this trilemma in blockchain. So this challenge, the blockchain trilemma is between the decentralization, scalability, and security. So the system can have either of these two out of these three. Therefore, we call it a trilemma in the blockchain. There are certain blockchain environment like NEO and US, which satisfy the scalability and decentralization, but security is questionable. We have the systems like Oracle, which is decentralized one. There is no decentralization, but it satisfies the other properties like scalability and security. And the systems like Ethereum and Bitcoin, they are decentralization, maintains better security, but scalability is a questionable for them. Now we'll discuss that how we will have, or how can we approach for a scalable solutions, whether there is some alternates. So before running to that, let us understand what are the affecting factors for scalability in blockchain. The factors could be that one is the the major or the important factor would be the number of transactions in a block. If the number of transactions in a block increases, then certainly the block size will increase. Okay, the block size will increase. And similarly, what about the size of transactions? Okay, so now if these numbers, again, the size of block increases, then again, how will I communicate? Because the network bandwidth requirement is more and it won't reach to the end of the other end of the system. Similarly, frequency of blocks added to the chain. Now it is 10 minutes. If I make it to the less than that, make it the 1 minute, then what will happen? Then at the same time, the block information, the validation, the block information must reach to the others. Then how nodes collaborate in the chain? How nodes are transactions to the chain? Just for a small interruptions, can you see my slides movement? Anyone can answer, please?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Thanks. Right. Well, so let us understand the idea that how here, what we understand here is that Can we increase the number of transactions without increasing the data? Then hopefully the problem would be solved. Okay. So one idea could be that don't record every transactions on the chain. Only record the settlements. That means you record the settlements, because let me take an example that I am using many transactions to my, I'm going to a coffee shop and taking coffee, say 10 times per day. Then rather than paying each and every time to the coffee shop, so the blockchain making one transaction, I can put it just on the record. Only the settlement will be given to the blockchain. That means the blockchain will be used to solve the disputes, nothing else. How the idea could be, it is better solutions, of course. It works fine as long as the things are good. Everything goes well. But if things go bad, or I don't trust it, I took the coffee and I'm not paying, or if I paid in advance, after all, he didn't pay the coffee, and it becomes more and more times, then the blockchain interference will be more and more. That the blockchain is involved to solve the dispute more times. No use of it. Okay. Then another alternate, which is in progress, of course, in using now, is that SegWit. So it increases the number of transactions without increasing the size of the block. This name is called SegWit because the segregation of witness, so called SegWit. What does it do with that? If you look at these are the fields, and there is a field which is called the witness, right? So in this block, I will have a list of witness, that is signatures, one for each input. Okay, one transaction may have four inputs, so the four witness will be there. So that can be segregated out to keep it in the block. Then it is observed that around 60% of space is for the witness. So let us not to keep it out, we'll keep it separately. Okay. Let me take a break of 5 seconds, 5 to 10 seconds. If any questions, I'm happy to share, happy to answer. Hope so, no questions. Well, so now I'm going to a different concept, that the payment channel. The idea is just, I would say that this, but not exactly the conceptually same, but the, you can say that the objective would be identical to this. Let me take a simple example. That's Alice takes coffee in the Bob's coffee shop. It takes a click. So what does it do? It paid the 0.01 Bitcoin, which is the charge of a cup of coffee, to Bob. Bob has given a cup of coffee, Alice took it and happily went for his law, for a law. And the next, she came again, paid one more transaction, performed one more transaction of 0.01, and took one more cup of coffee. It's fine. But what happens if Alice is taking so frequently? So actually, it is each and every time it paying the making a transaction to the Bob. You must be knowing that for a transaction, Alice pays a transaction fees, which is not to the Bob, which is paying to the blockchain. So rather than paying a number of transactions fees to Bob, and one thing more is that the each time one transaction is to be posted in the blockchain. Rather doing this, because this is inefficient to use the main blockchain for small transactions. Rather than doing so, let Alice put certain money or perform a transaction, kept this transaction blocking for the name of Bob. And take a cup of coffees So that is one transaction she did, and take as many as copies she like within that amount. And after that, she settles it down. Just like that, what you do is here, that even when you are studying, what you are doing, that you pay certain amount to a the hotels, right? And then we'll settle it out after 5 or 6. Okay, this is the amount I took my meals, and the rest amount the hotel owner has to give me. Okay, just like that, what I will do is here. So the solution is to set up a multi-signature address that is shared by Alice and Bob's KF. So she firstly she stored here, say, 1 bitcoin, then took a cup of coffee. And what are you doing? After taking your meals in the hotel, you are signing there, right? You signed it there. Okay, today is say 20th, I took this meal, 21st, I took this meal, 25th, I took this meal. And I'm taking that, okay, this all it takes 10 meals I have taken, this is the amount I have paid, and so on. You are settling it out. Exactly the same concept we are doing it. Well, now, so settle this amount afterwards, and she gets the different things, the rest amount. This idea, of course, is by Han and Spielman. They published this thing, that unidirectional Bitcoin micropayment channel with Bitcoin contract. But requirement is that Alice needs a way to ensure that refund of funds here. Because you know what is happening. Here Alice put it that, okay, 1 bitcoin for Bob. And after taking each cup of coffee, she is signing and giving her. Now when Bob will show this thing, oh, you took it 3 cups of coffee to the blockchain, and then one transaction will happen. She will get the 0.97 and you will get 0.03 Bitcoin. But the problem comes that if Bob does not want to settle, then Alice is not getting anything. This 1 Bitcoin is there in the blockchain. Okay. So to resolve these issues, what you can do, Alice needs a way to ensure that refund of funds should be there. So if Bob does not publish after some time, Alice gets 1 Bitcoin refunded. So the refund transaction signed before funding account AB. So in unspent transaction output UTXO implemented with the time lock, this is locked for a particular time. And in Ethereum, it is implemented as smart contract. So once Alice sent 1 Bitcoin to Bob, channel is adjusted, of course, because this channel is for only 1 Bitcoin. Okay. This payment channel using the smart contract in the Solidity language is this part. Okay. So not going to detail, it is very simple programs, of course. You must have seen some programs, and you will see it, some programs in the smart contract in the next classes or so by somebody. Now, the next question comes that if Alice and Bob both want to move funds back and forth, means Alice can transfer amount to Bob, and Bob also can transfer some amount to Alice. So that is two, so in this case, 2 unidirectional channels has to be established as per this paper, what we discussed. If you have the 2 unidirectional channels, what will happen, you know? Let us say first, Alice and Bob, so A to B, that is a 5 Bitcoin. And from B to A, he has also established 5 Bitcoin. Okay, we can say that 2 payment channel they established. Now, Alice purchased certain things from Bob. So from 5 Bitcoin, it becomes 3, 2, and 1, then it becomes 0. In the meanwhile, Bob also returning something. Bob purchased certain things from Alice and given it, 3, 2, and so on. So in the Bob to Alice, in this channel, Bob is having some amount, say 3. But Alice to Bob channel is having 0. So now, though it is having something, Alice cannot spend it with Bob. that the channel gets adjusted. So that is the most problem which could exist with this two different channels, two different unidirectional channels between two parties. So then one proposal from the Poon and Drija in 2016. This is a very interesting topic, that there is a bi-directional payment channel. They will establish a bi-directional payment channel. So what the Ellis and Bob does is that we call it collateral. Say Ellis pays an amount of 5 Bitcoin, Bob pay amounts 5 Bitcoin. So now 10 Bitcoin is there in this collateral. So out of these 10 collaterals, Ellis can expand it, okay, towards Bob, and Bob can to the Ellis, and the total will be here. So the channel adjusted exhaustion will not occur. Let's say Ellis spent 5 Bitcoin. So he's having now what? 0, and he's having 10. After that, Bob has given, say, 3. Then Ellis will have 3, and Bob will have 7. So now the channel is not adjusted now. So that's what I mean to say. Is this idea clear? The bi-directional payment channel? Let me wait for 5 to 10 seconds, if any questions. Hope so, no questions. Anyway, so this is the things what I told you that, okay? Later than for settlement, what Bob does is that Bob will settle it out. If Ellis says, no, I need to settle it because I have a nonce value which is more than this nonce value, then this will be valid than this. Okay. More number of nonce in the sense, the one more in the newer transactions that already happened, what Bob is hiding to. Therefore, so. Okay. So this is the Ellis and Bob want to move funds back and forth. Now, Ellis submits the balance and signature to construct start challenge period. If Bob can submit a transaction with greater nonce, new state is valid. Then you can close the transactions. In this similar way, in the Ethereum, the smart contract that implements a game between the Ellis and Bob. The game has the states and the channel occurs just as it is cast. Therefore, it's called the state channel rather than the payment channel. We'll look into practical network, which is called a Lightning network, the way it uses this payment channel network concept. So see here, the same examples I'm repeating. Let's say Ellis deposits 0.05 Bitcoin and Bob deposits 0.00, because now you see, though it is a collateral, but Bob no need to pay because it is the copy vending machines and Ellis will take coffee from here, but each need to pay. That means it is paying 0 and Bob 0.05. And they deposited it. Okay, that is one transaction happened. So multi-signature address is like a wall that can be opened when both parties agree and they establish a payment channel. Now payment channel is established on main blockchain by two on-chain transactions. Two on-chain transactions in the sense, one on-chain transaction is for opening, other on-chain transaction is for closing. In between, all the transactions between the Ellis and Bob happens an off-chain, that is without interference of blockchain. Therefore, we call it is an off-chain transaction. Now, Ellis can share her 0.05 Bitcoin. Bob can see that Ellis had 0.05 Bitcoin in my name with Bob. So Bob now given coffee. He ordered a coffee and given the coffee to Alice. Then again, order coffee and give coffee to Alice, and so on. So after giving a cup of coffee, it will become 0.04, this is 0.01, okay? And Alice will sign here, Bob will sign here. So now this is. Next, he took another copy, 0.03 with Alice, 0.02 with Bob, and then they will sign. This is multi-signatures. Okay, now in this time, let Alice want to settle down to get the rest amount and Bob's too. So Bob will request, and if Alice can submit this with a greater nonce value, then he will get it. Otherwise, the rest amount will be given to him and to Bob, the same amount to be given to Bob. Well, it works fine. Alice goes to Bob Cafe and orders a cup of coffee. It's a cost. Payment channel ledger is updated off-chain. Alice and Bob sign the updated balance sheet and each keep a copy of the ledger, just what I told you. This is the paper Poon and Thaddeus published in white paper in February 2015 for Lightning Network. And it is used, of course, I would say that they use this concept in 2018 or so. So Alice can continue to buy the cup of coffee until balance is adjusted. There is no limit on the number of transactions per second because these transactions are happening off chain. And remember that if somehow Alice is having the biscuits and Bob is having the coffee, and Bob can buy the biscuits from the Alice also. This can be, updated accordingly. So remember that the highlighted portion, the payment channel can be closed at any time. Either party simply needs to take the latest ledger, which is signed by both parties, and broadcast it to the network. Miners verify the signatures on the ledger and then relay the funds. This is an on-chain transaction. Now, so any party can relay the funds, even if one party does not want to relay the funds. This problem gets avoided, what I told you at the beginning. And there is no way for Alice to hold Bob hostage for the funds. Next important thing is that, let's say Alice don't have a payment channel. Alice does not have a payment channel with Bob, but Alice has a payment channel with his Bob brother, say Charlie. And Charlie is having a payment channel with Bob. So they can establish a payment channel network that Alice will pay to Bob, Charlie, and Charlie will talk to Bob. Okay. Well, so Alice can take a copy from Bob's copy shop, throw the payment occur through Charlie. So Alice pay to Charlie, and Charlie pays to Bob. So like that way, the network find the fastest and cheapest way to connect A to B. It's also important that the channels have enough funds to do the transactions. I mean, of course, it is pretty sure that if Alice want to pay to Bob, say, 10 Bitcoin, but in this Alice to Cam is having 12 Bitcoin, so this is okay. But if Cam to Bob is having only 5, then this channel, this network cannot be established. This path cannot be established. So no locking up of funds. If the other party goes offline or tries anything shady, you can broadcast your transaction to the blockchain immediately and get your money out yourself. Minimizes on-chain transactions. So the low fees required, unlimited instant payments, microtransactions pay possible, and end user behavior is exactly like an on-chain hot wallet. Okay? It makes more sense with stablecoins. In early days, it is mainly an idea with a testnet in early 2018. But you can see that in 2019, February, there are 3,075 public nodes with 24,618 channels. But I could see just 17th in December 2021, The number of nodes is 31,746 with the channels 83,352. The routing implements the on-end routing in these protocols. Each node only sees the immediate hop before and after. This calls the onion because the routing information is wrapped in layers as you see in the onions, right? If I remove the upper layer, then I will get the next. And I can find that, okay, this is the destination. I will send it to my neighbor. And my neighbor, again, just it wrap out so that it can see the address of the next neighbor and so on and so on. So therefore, this is called the onion routing. Like your Tor is using the onion routing protocol too. Okay. Well, I will now summarize the payment channel network with a clear-cut picture, how it happens. And then we'll see that what issues is there, and how Lightning Network resolved it out. And then we'll see that what the recent literatures work. Even our one paper, our two works is published with these in the similar directions too. So here, what I want to say that, let's say S the sender and R the receiver. Let's say sender S wants to pay a certain amount to the receiver R, but it does not have a, you can say the channel, direct channel to R. But S has a channel to U1, U1 has a channel with U2, U2 has a channel with U3, U3 has a channel with R. And this is the collateral values, what is mentioned here. Then what does it do? Now, what it will do is that the first things that establish the payment channel, I would assume that the open channel, which is already over here, then the off-chain transactions occur. So S paid that $30 to R and tell me, oh, I see that you please pay the $30 to R. I will pay the 0.3 Bitcoin as the transaction fees. Okay. Then U1, what does it do? It forwards, it keeps its own transaction fees. So 0.3, let's say transaction fee 0.1, then it keeps its own transaction fees and send it to the next 0.2. 0.3 minus 0.1 is 0.2. Similarly, when U2, okay, I got it $30. I need to pay to the U3, provide I will get the transaction fees of 0.1. So it becomes this. And U3 keeps its own transaction fees of 0.1 amount and send the $30 to receiver R. So now the where the collateral value is updated like this way. Okay. Now what happens? You see that the question comes that if S has given to U1, U1 has given to U2, U2 didn't give to U3, and so on. So the partial updates can lead to a coin losses for the users on the bot. Okay. I would say that, okay, U2 tell, no, I will not give you. I will not give to U3. That's your business. Then what will happen? U1 already kept his transaction fees. If he returns the $30, okay, let you take your $30, but I will not pay the transaction fees because I already made the transactions. So I used some computation power on this. So why should I return the transaction fees? So the partial updates can lead to coin losses. For instance, a user could pay a certain amount of Bitcoin to the next user in the path, but never receive the corresponding Bitcoin from the previous neighbor. This is what I told. So this actually necessitates one more concept, which is called the atomicity. You must have heard this word atomicity. Either the entire transaction or nothing. So either all guys, S to U1, U1 to U2, U2 to U3, U3 to R, all will make the transaction or nobody will make the transactions. That is called the atomicity. So this atomicity will avoid this like losses, coin losses. So either the capacity of all channel in the path is updated or none of the channel is changed. So Lightning Network adopts, which is called a host time lock contract to achieve this. Called the host time lock contract, or we call it the HTLC protocol. This is as follows. So what Alice does is that Alice will send to Bob, okay, means Alice to Bob and Bob to Carol, Carol to David. This is requirement. And they have the channels. Now they want to establish a host time lock contract with this Alice to David. Okay. Well, so before coming to the host time lock contract, let me refresh your memory with the host function, what a host function is. A cryptographic host function accepts the arbitrary length message as input, and the output is a fixed length host digest, what I call the Y. So I call that Y is equal to H of X, H is the cryptographic host function. And this satisfies the properties, the three cryptographic important properties. One is that pre-image resistant property, that by knowing Y is equal to H of X, it is computationally infeasible to find X. This is called the pre-image resistant property. Okay. Second property says that second pre-image resistant property, that means I have given Y is equal to H of X. And you are given X also, that means I've given a pair XY such that Y is equal to H of X. And it is computationally infeasible to find X prime such that Y is equal to H of X prime. Is equal to H of X. So mark the difference. The attacker or some party is given XY pair, and you need to find out X prime Y such that H of X prime is equal to Y. Okay, this is computational infeasible. Third property we call the collision resistant property, or we call sometimes strong collision resistant property. This sometimes we call the weak collision resistant property also. Okay, those is collision resistant property says that you need to find out a pair X and X prime such that H of X is equal to H of X prime. So you are not given anything, you find out any X and X prime such that H of X is equal to H of X prime. And this is computationally infeasible for a better cryptographic hash function. Well, now let's see that how the HTLC work out and what the problem is there and how the people work with to resolve these issues. Even we also published the papers on to resolve these issues recently. Right. So what the sender does is that the receiver need to accept certain amount. He will send S, which is the H of R. H of R. So this S will be given to him, right? So he tells that, okay, you listen. If somebody gives you R, you give him the amount. So that it is understood that I will get that amount. That is host time lock contract. Okay. So this contract will be valid. Now you see the contract, how does it work? Now S will have a contract with U1 that, oh, U1, you see, I'm giving you the value V1. The V1 is including this amount value V plus the transaction fees of U1, U2, U3, all transaction fees. This is V1 and this S, what he obtained this S value and T1. He will tell that, S will tell that, okay, if you can provide me this R value corresponding to this S before time T1, I will pay you this V amount. But you want to see that, okay, oh, this is a challenge. He will take, he will prepare one more contract with U2, okay? U1 and U2, within these two, the contract is as follows. Okay, I will give you V2 amount by extracting my fees, right? That is the V1 minus its fees, that is V2. And say that, okay, before time T2, if you can provide me the corresponding value of R, I will pay you this amount V2. U2 does not know the value of R. Okay, so he will forward it to the U3. He will tell that, okay, can you give me the corresponding R within time T3 so that I will pay you this amount? Then U3 does not know. He will pass to R. He will tell that, okay, R, can you give me the corresponding R before time T4? I will give you V4 by keeping my transaction fees. Now this is the contract between these. You see that T1 greater than T2 greater than T3 greater than T4. That means, assume that T1 is 4 hours, T2 is 3 hours, T3 is 2 hours, T4 is 1 hour. But R knows it. So this R gives it R to U3. This is a contract. So nobody can cheat it. That is the trusted contract. So once R given this R, U3 immediately pays this V4 amount. This V4 is nothing but EGV amount. And once it gets this, that means what? The right side contract is open now. Then the left side contract gets open because he has paid, he has shown this R to him. Right? And he will get it, and so on, and so on, and everybody get it. Now what happens? Now either each party will get this value or no party will get this value. So this is called the half sign log contract. Now it is achieving the atomicity property also. Any questions until this? I'll tell you a simple attack to this scenario. You see, what will happen that this U3, it is not secure. This, the question is that whether STLC is secure, it's no. The honest participant would lose money. What does it do with that? You see, say U3 and U1 are colluded. So U3 does not send this R value to this two. U2, he sends, because U3 and U1 are colluded, compromised. You can assume that this is the same party, he the father and he the son and so on. So he will share it to his own person, this R directly, because he got the R and he give this R to this. And once he gets this R value, U1 gets it to S. Now S released it, S released the amount. When S released the amount U1, U1 got it. And U3 got it, R got it, the amount, but U2 did not get it, though it is participated at the beginning. That means the honest participant would lose money, that is the money in the sense transaction fees, not the entire, but the transaction fees. This attack is called the wormhole attack. In network, you must have heard this wormhole attack. That means the U1 and U3 has established a wormhole path so that U3 has given this R to him. Am I clear now? So to get the solution, a proposal is given by Malhotra et al. In 2017. Very interesting protocol. I will just move it out. They set up the S, send the U1, U2, U3, and R, these values. And the next stage, see S, U1, V1, Y3, T1, then U1 will check it that whether this is correct or not. S3, Pi3, Pi3 is nothing but these proof protocols. This is a non-interactive, zero knowledge proof protocol, and they will get it. And once they get it, now it will accept, it release this, and then this happens. Now let me tell, because I don't have much more time, so just let me wind up here, that you see here, it is not possible. Let's say the same thing happens, this U3 and U4 are colluded, a U1 are colluded. then U3, if U3 releases these two directly to U1, it cannot win because it does not have the corresponding X2. The X2 is lying with U2 only. So this attack will not work here. So this protocol is wormhole resistant protocol. And of course, this though it is valid, but the problem is that the sender S is sending to each party these things, right? That means the sender anonymity is not there. So what we did is that we proposed a protocol, small protocol, in the financial cryptography conference that called as MAPPCN, where the sender anonymity could be preserved. Okay. For more details, you can see this reference, and I will stop it here, and I will wait for if any questions here. Yeah. If any questions, I'm happy to hear. Yes, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Hello. Yeah. Any questions? Okay, I'm done. I think if any questions, I'm happy to answer it.
Dear participants, please, do you have any questions? Please post your questions.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah, good morning. Please try.
Sir, can you suggest any kind of algorithms in order to overcome the scalability problem that we are facing in the blockchain? Few algorithms like which are existing.
I couldn't get it. What regarding or with reference to which problem of the blockchain you are talking?
Like in the blockchain, we have a throughput problem now, sir.
Just as I told you that the problems, just we discuss the solutions, right? One problem I discussed, that the hash time lock contract, which is existing in the Lightning network, of course, they are using. And now they changed a little bit also, but this is the problem, that what you call it, the wormhole attack. And to mitigate this attack, we discussed also the solutions by AMHL protocol, and I showed you just in a raw way that our protocol too.
Okay. Any other kind of few more algorithms, just like memes, so that we can refer after the end of the session?
Yeah, we proposed two protocols. One is the, I can just, let me share it out. I thought that the time I will give it for the questions. So I, well, just a minute. Let me share the things. Hope you could see my slides, right? Okay, this is one protocol we have discussed, we have proposed in financial cryptography workshop and in financial cryptography conference in 2020, right? And after that, of course, this protocol is using, you see, that the many computational intensive operations like the point multiplications, elliptic or point multiplications. So later on, I thought that it will be better that if you can avoid this intensive computations, then recently we proposed one more protocol, which is called the NSTLC, which is suitable for the garlic routing protocols rather than onion writing protocols. Then of course the reviewers asked that why only garlic routing? Can you suggest something for the onion routing, which is related to the Sphinx protocol too? Then in the same paper, we again published one more protocol also that is related, called as the KTLC, the symmetric key based time lock contract, which is compatible to the Sphinx protocol. This is published in Computer Security Elsevier Journal in 2021. You can see from there, or you can check it from my homepage and look at this and click it, that you can get that paper also.
Thank you, sir. Well, it's a very wonderful session, sir. I have gained lot of information from the content what you have shared, and if possible try to share the PPT, sir, at the end of the session.
Madam, we will share the PPT, sir.
Please repeat about honest participants will lose money. Yeah, so if this question, just let me share it out. Let me go through this slide of the STLC. Yeah. Okay, so here you see that what happening, and now it is the STLC protocol. First phase is running as it is. Okay, the contract is started. In the next phase, when R reveals the value of small r, okay, now U3 says like, okay, my rights are contract open now, all right? Then U3 does not reveal to U2. He is revealing this R value to U1. Now you see that because this is the same value, so U1 got R, and now this chain is started from S. So now the S will give the money to whom? U1, and U1, this contract is started, so U1 will pay to U3, and U3 pay to R. Now U2 is not getting money, that the honest participant lost this transaction fees. I think that is the question from perhaps Dr. Jagdish Garg. Very clear?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Okay, thanks.